The world of psychoanalysis most usually can be described as people describe the Vienna Philharmonic. The audience in Vienna is either gray or dyed hair or bald. This is something for people who are of a completely different age than the people who work and come to Stillpoint spaces are. So I'm very happy to be able to contribute and to be part of this, I wouldn't call it institution, but of this community that hopefully will bring some fresh air that the world of psychoanalysis needs a lot. I would like to point your attention to my email addresses. In the case you have any questions or comments or feedback between the lectures, please feel free to use any or both. This is probably particularly interesting to people who hopefully follow us now via internet. They will not be able to ask questions at this moment, I guess, but hopefully could write to me later. For you who are present here, I would like to ask you to feel free to interrupt me at any moment. What I will try to do tonight and the next five meetings is to summarize something of about 120 years of psychoanalytic history in 90 minutes. And then I will not be able to do justice to many important persons, ideas, concepts, experiments, and so on and so on. But please feel free, if I'm condensing too much, to interrupt me and ask me to give you more details, or if you want to add anything about what I'm missing, so please feel free to make this as interactive as possible. My idea was not to present the history of psychoanalysis in the way that it usually is presented. So start with Freud and then go chronologically toward 2016 and then mention all the important names in their chronological order and how they quarreled and how they married and so on and so on. I thought what we might do in a way that is fresher and more interesting is try to cut through the cake, to cut the slices. So as psychoanalysis has many different faces, many different strands, I will try to show you over the next 6 weeks what psychoanalysis as a treatment might be, and then it has one very complicated strand. Is it a science? Some psychoanalysts are very strongly about it. It will never be a science, and it should never be a science. Jakob told you my affiliation here in Berlin is a psychoanalytic university, so some people work on it as a science. If it is a science, then what kind of a science is it? It's difficult to say. Then psychoanalysis is a sort of psychology. It tells you about personality, it tells you about development. Then psychoanalysts would like to interpret more or less everything. Archaeology, history, culture, society, arts, politics, wars, whatever. And finally, Freud believed, and many people believe with him, and there is a very strong psychoanalytic school which is close to this, that psychoanalysis is a philosophical worldview. Once you get infected by psychoanalysis, you start looking at the world psychoanalytically. Your viewpoint of the world is psychoanalytic. So my plan was, over the next 6 weeks, to present to you the history of psychoanalysis, not chronologically, but to try to talk about treatment today, then about science, and so on and so on. So each time I will try to start with the beginning, the first ideas, and then try to see how they changed, and then try to conclude where we are today. About this last, of course, it would be most interesting that we talk together. For those of you who would hopefully follow the whole series, I would like to turn your attention to June 16th. We will not meet. I'm sorry, I will be traveling for a conference, will not be in Berlin. We will end with a topic that may be interesting for some of you in various ways and that is not challenged often enough, and that is the history of psychoanalysis as a profession. What kind of a profession is it? How do we organize as professionals? That will be the end on the last day of June. So I will start today with asking this question: what kind of treatment is psychoanalysis? I'm sure we all know there are all sorts of treatments. Medical, scientifically based, some of those that science would never follow, some of those that some scientists follow, and so on and so on. Where is psychoanalysis in all that? Is it a medical treatment? Is it a psychological treatment? Is it something similar to those guys who would help you with your spinal cord, but they are not medical doctors, they are not, they didn't go to university or whatever? Where are we? Where is our position? What is it that we do? We would like to believe that we help people. If we do, then how do we do that? So I've tried to summarize what we do as psychoanalysts in several short ideas that each of them probably could be discussed over one semester. The first thing I believe a psychoanalyst does is provide a safe space where the person, some people might even start learning how to self-reflect. We hope to provide a safe space where people will become motivated to look inside and learn about themselves in the ways they cannot do outside of this setting or they have never learned how to do. One point here that I think is particularly important is when you think about the year 2016 or the 21st century in general, we have developed dozens or hundreds of ways of forgetting the pain that we bear inside. Psychoanalysis might be, or psychotherapy, maybe more broadly speaking, maybe the only space where you might feel safe to finally meet your pain, to finally experience what you were suffering from all your life but never were strong enough or supported enough to meet that. Then we should hopefully provide a model for self-reflection. Our clients learn from us as role models, looking at the way how we ask questions, looking at the way how we endure something, how we are not afraid of admitting our mistakes. And then they start using this as a model in their own lives. It may sound preposterous, but when we start talking about science, I will try to show you the parallels between infant research and psychotherapy. As infants and children learn the skills of what we call mentalization or social cognition or emotional intelligence, they don't learn it through instruction, but through observation, through identification. So the same happens in psychotherapy, hopefully. There are very difficult moments in many psychotherapeutic treatments. We call them attacks on linking, on thinking, on setting. Different names are used for it. But more or less in each long-term psychoanalytic treatment, there will be at least one period when the client will be very negative about everything you're doing. Sometimes many authors write about what you need to do is just endure these attacks. Just stay alive, just survive them, and the person will gain something from it and improve thanks to it. Just one short remark. If you have any interest in any specific topic that I'm mentioning, please interrupt me and ask me for a reference, and I will try to tell you where the basic source of what I'm talking about is. Psychoanalysis, of course, is recognized and defined by its focus on unconscious motivation. From the late 19th century, psychoanalysts focus on this idea. There is something in the unconscious that influences our behavior without our being aware of it. That's why Freud's conception, and we'll talk about that in 2 weeks from now, is called dynamic unconscious. There were many different conceptions of the unconscious in the 19th century. Freud provided the idea of how dynamically the unconscious influences consciousness and how, to a small extent, consciousness could influence the unconscious. We try to recognize the past patterns in the present. When we listen to our clients, we try to recognize how they organize their social relationships, how they express their emotions, how they attach to other people, how they think, based on their early experiences. So we try to help them somehow get rid of that, get free of that, and start thinking fresh in their own way. It is, I think, very striking, probably in every long-term psychoanalytic treatment, how people discover how much of our personalities is not our own, in fact. How much of our personalities is taken from other people or developed as a stance against other people and so on. Then it takes time to discover who are you authentically? What is the authentical part of yourself and expression of yourself? And finally, we try to recognize various irrational feelings people might have toward their therapists. We have technical names for this, of course, but sometimes we feel very positive emotions toward our therapists, or very negative emotions, or emotions changing from a moment to a moment, or we forget something about our therapist or come late to the session and so on and so on, because of some irrational feelings that usually belong to the past, and we now focus them on the psychotherapist. At this moment, there are more than 400 different schools, so to say, of psychotherapy in the world. I hope this can, to a certain extent, define psychoanalysis so that if you would look at other 499, you would be able to say they are different than this. They do not fit into this. So to define psychoanalytic treatment, it is very important not to think behaviorally. I've put here the photograph of Professor Horst Kechele, who's done a lot of research on how does psychoanalysis help? Why is it effective? So his research shows that whether you come 2 times or 4 times per week, in most cases, on average, does not make a difference. It may make a difference in an individual case. On average, in a large sample, it doesn't. Whether you use the couch or the patient is using the armchair does not make a difference. Lay analysis, so by a person who is not a medical doctor, or a medical doctor becoming a psychiatrist, becoming a psychotherapist, becoming a psychoanalyst, does not make a difference. There is something called shuttle analysis. People who live in places where there are no psychoanalytic institutes would travel, for instance, some of my friends traveled from Bulgaria to Belgrade, or they would travel from Russia to Finland, or from Zagreb to Amsterdam, and so on and so on. So they would stay there for 2 weeks, have very intensive analysis over 2 weeks, and then go home for 6 weeks, no analysis for 6 weeks. Then 2 weeks, very intense, then 6 weeks, no analysis. Completely different than what we would usually think. So we are working now on the study that should tell us whether it's as effective as the usual analysis. And finally, there is something called distance analysis, using Skype or phones or text messages. So we're working on studies now to show whether this is as effective or not. Most probably, psychoanalysis should not be defined by how you behave. It should be defined by the way of matching between the two persons, the understanding, whether the process is developing, whether the person is dreaming and developing transference and so on and so on. What is effective? We will come to that in a moment, hopefully. So this is the classical setting. So this is how classical psychoanalysts work or used to work. A 15-minute hour, a 10-minute break, and then the next session. Sometimes Freud used to work 10 to 12 sessions per day, 6 days per week, sometimes even on Sundays. Classical psychoanalysis uses the couch, and the patient who is on the couch is asked to, we say, free associate. We don't say this to the patient. We don't use the word free associate. We ask the patient to say whatever comes to his or her mind. Whether it seems stupid, whether it seems embarrassing, whether it seems irrelevant, doesn't matter. Just say it, just talk freely, openly, and then we will see where that leads. Freud, initially in his papers on psychoanalytic technique, recommended that we should be like blank screens, like this. So the patient will be able to project what is in his or her unconscious onto us, and we will be able to understand and interpret that. So this was the basic setting: the time, the space, what the patient should do, and what we should do. These were the recommendations of probably 105 years ago. So this is just one photograph of what it looks like in London now, Freud Museum, London. This is the famous couch. This is where Freud used to sit. This is where he used to write for the last about year and a half of his life when he moved to London. So psychoanalysis is an effective form of treatment. For a long time, we will talk about that next week, psychoanalysts didn't want to study and see whether what they do really helps people or not. Over the last probably 20 years, there were more and more studies, and they're basically showing this. I'm underlining here the work of Jonathan Shadler, one of the most important psychotherapy researchers today. Psychoanalysis is superior to any other form of psychotherapy if it lasts more than 18 months. So it requires a long time. The reason why psychoanalysis is effective is most probably what we call post-treatment effects. Once the treatment is over, the person who has been in the psychoanalytic treatment continues to develop. The growth continues. In other forms of treatment, we haven't found this effect so far. So what probably helps most is that you develop skills for becoming your own analyst after your personal analysis, which lasts at least a year and a half. However, I hasten to add, it's very important to be aware of it. Psychoanalysis cannot help everyone. There are data from the Anna Freud Center in London showing that if you had a bad treatment in childhood, you will develop worse than the person who didn't have any treatment. There are data showing that maybe even every fourth person in psychoanalytic treatment does not improve, and that maybe even every 10th person who is in psychoanalytic treatment may deteriorate. So yes, it's effective on average. On average, it helps people, yet there are individual cases when it does not. Yes, please.
Are you saying that for those people it is actually counterproductive?
Yes. Yes. It is counterproductive to be in a psychoanalytic treatment. We don't know exactly which aspect of a psychoanalytic treatment is detrimental to them. But there is something, one or more, which makes them even worse than they were when they came.
And what are the preconditions and what is bad childhood then?
About this study?
Yeah.
Children would come to the Anna Freud Center, I think the late 60s or the early 70s, for various sorts of problems, various diagnoses. And they were in treatment. And some treatments ended favorably, and some treatments ended bad, in the opinion of the psychotherapist. So Professor Mary Target, she wrote her PhD, she found these people 20 years later and interviewed them to see how they developed, 20 or 25 years later. And she found this. She did not specify the diagnosis as far as I know. Yes? Here, there are various ways. You can do self-reports, you can do projective techniques, self-reports are psychological techniques where people are asked to describe themselves related to one issue or the other. You may use something like ink blots or other projective techniques. You may use the assessment of other psychotherapists who would interview the person. And in the last 15 years, I will talk about that next week, more and more institutes use magnetic resonance. They would scan your brain at the beginning of the treatment and then scan your brain a year and then at the end of the treatment and try to look at even physiological and anatomical differences in your brain when it comes to pre and post in psychoanalysis. So, how did it all start and how did it all develop? This is something, hopefully, about what it is. Very brief. We all believe that it had all started with Freud. Freud is an icon now. More or less everyone in the Western world and now in Latin America and in Asia, and everyone knows about the name and the bearded guy and the cigar and the couch and so on and so on. In his famous Clark lectures, given in 1909 at the American University, which honored him with a doctorate, Freud honestly said, psychoanalysis was invented by Joseph Breuer. Breuer was older than Freud, a very good GP, general practitioner in Vienna, very good doctor who used to listen to his patients. Later on, he supported Freud. They wrote a book together, and Freud learned many of the most important things from him. What is also very important to note, this is the book, The Studies About Hysteria. This is the book that opens the German edition of the Freud psychoanalytic works. This is a book with cases about female patients, and this is the person who, in fact, invented psychoanalysis. This was a young, educated woman from Vienna who was, as they would say it at that time, hysterical. Today we would probably use a more complicated diagnosis for her state. Her real name was Bertha Pappenheim, and she was treated by Breuer for several years for various symptoms, as you can see, including hallucinations and split personality and something that we would consider either borderline or psychotic. At a certain moment in the treatment, the young woman told Breuer what helped her most was to be able to talk to him. She called this talking cure, as she had started at one moment to use English instead of German. We don't know why. So the phrasing of psychoanalysis as a talking cure comes from a patient. So she would talk and talk and talk, and she would feel relieved. Another word she used was that this was chimney sweeping. So talking was helpful. How did it help? One of her symptoms, one of the most famous symptoms she suffered from, was that she was disgusted by water. She was afraid of water. She wouldn't touch water. She wouldn't drink water. So talking and talking and talking, she at one moment mentioned that long time ago she had seen a dog drink water from the glass, which people used. And she was so disgusted from seeing a dog drink water like people should drink it that she couldn't touch water anymore. The moment she remembered it, the symptom disappeared and water was not a problem anymore. So this will be one of the foundations of psychoanalysis. Freud and Breuer published several versions of this story. There are books devoted to it, what really happened and how it really developed. Unfortunately, she was referred to an asylum and she tried to commit suicide and she never had a family. This is a poem. This is the title of a poem she wrote later on, Love Did Not Come to Me. And she was a very important social worker in Germany. She moved from Austria to Germany, and this is how she was honored after the World War II. During the Nazi years, all her institutions were destroyed. So out of this, we come to Freud at the first moment when his work really becomes important. Freud couldn't become a neurologist. We will talk about that next week, how he wanted to be a scientist. He turned to private practice. He started seeing patients. He worked huge amount of hours, and in the mid-1890s, he suffered from a psychological crisis after the death of his father. At that moment, Freud was 40 years old. His father died, and Freud was depressed. He started using half an hour or 1 hour to think about his symptoms every evening, to think about his dreams, to think about his fantasies, to think about his problems, problematic emotions. So at that moment, he believed that most of his patients suffered from being traumatized. He believed that his patients suffered from sexual molestation in early childhood. Many, especially of the female patients he had, were telling him this. In this very important, probably the most important letter in the history of psychoanalysis, he wrote to his friend Wilhelm Fliss, who lived here in Berlin, who was a medical doctor here, how he had developed, how he had discovered the pattern that he felt in love with his mother and jealous of his father. And he felt that he had discovered the pattern that would explain everything about psychology and later on about other disciplines. He believed every boy, everywhere in the world, at any point in time, so 500 years ago, 5,000 years ago, whenever, felt the same, being in love with his mother and being jealous of his father. This is what later will become famous as Oedipus complex, and we will return to that when we talk about psychoanalysis as a personality theory. This is the basis of Freudian approach to personality dynamics. So, this is what the work of psychoanalysts mostly is based. As Jakob already said in his introduction, do you interpret or do you get in a relationship? That's the basic dilemma. That's the basic crossroads that you choose, which way to go. I will try to present both as succinctly as possible. The first one is called the conflict theory. This is the model based on the work of Freud on what I just said, the conflict between being in love and being jealous. So, in his probably most important book, published in the year 1900, The Interpretation of Dreams, Freud wrote about what he believed was the basic principle of our psychological life. Freud is the most prominent representative in the history of psychology of the so-called conflict model. Like Karl Marx is in, say, sociology or political science, Freud is in psychology. For Freud, there is one point that can never be questioned, and that is the primary importance of a conflict. What he struggles about over the development of his theory is what is in conflict with what. What is it that is fighting against what? For the most part of his life, he believed one force was the sexual drive, that then he was looking for something that would be powerful enough to oppose the sexual drive. But the conflict was never questioned. Where is the conflict positioned? And we will talk about that in greater detail 2 weeks from today. The conflict is between the unfulfilled wishes and what is repressing or prohibiting them. In this book, it is called repression barrier. So your unconscious, Freud believed, was full of wishes that asked to be satisfied right here and right now. And there was a barrier, probably a rather thick one in most of civilized adults in the Western society, which would not allow these wishes to come to the consciousness. So all day long, all the time, you want to murder people, you want to rape people, you want to eat everything that is around you, you want to defecate wherever you want to, and so on and so on. Civilization would not allow you to do that. You're being educated by your parents would not allow you to do that. So what happens then? What happens with these wishes? Whatever you cannot express or satisfy during the day will come to you in your dream. When you fall asleep, when you're drunk, when you're naked, your repression barrier will loosen up and the unconscious will speak. It will send you coded messages that you will have to decipher with the use of Freudian psychoanalysis so that you would understand what happens inside of you. The same model, the very next year, about the book about the everyday life. So whenever Freud believed you forget a name, you forget a number, you forget a birthday, look into the unconscious. Your unconscious will tell you why exactly you have forgotten this. This is a hidden coded message which tells you something about your attitude toward the person or the event or something that is going on. So Freud believed years 1900 and 1901 that he had discovered the pattern. The unconscious is influencing our behavior in a coded way, and psychoanalysis is the method to decipher it. So we come, of course, to the most important of these coded messages, and these are the symptoms. As a person who worked in the clinical domain with patients, Freud believed symptoms to be another form of coded messages, and what a psychoanalyst should provide was deciphering of these messages, helping the patient understand what the symptom in fact means. I would just briefly like to tell you that this is considered to be the second revolution in the history of psychiatry. Someone not only talking to patients, but believing that there is meaning in madness. That when you listen to symptoms of neurotic or psychotic patients, there is some meaning in it. This will be strongly supported at the moment when Freud meets people who have far more experience than he had with psychotic patients, like Carl Gustav Jung and his hope to get Eugen Bleuler onto the psychoanalytic team, and then later on Ferenczi and Tausk, who were very experienced in this work. So building on the NaO case, Freud believed that the problem is that traumatic experience dissociates the event and the memory. So something happened, but I cannot remember it. I cannot think about it. So I have to do something. Because I don't remember it, I have to do something. And so the symptoms develop. Because Anna couldn't remember the dog and the scene she had seen, then she had to stop drinking water. The way to work against this is to reassociate what's been dissociated. So Freudian method is to help the patient understand that two things are connected logically, chronologically, or in other ways, that the patient does not see connected. To do that, I return to this sentence. We use free association. We try to help the patient speak his mind or her mind as freely as possible. And we hope at a certain moment the patient will start talking about something that is going on deep in the unconscious. Although the patient would say that, like poets used to say that before and after Freud, the patient will not be able to recognize where the problem was and where the solution is, unless the analyst would help. The way for analysts to help is, as I already told you, to be neutral, anonymous, and distant. This is what Freud believed. So the analyst should not say anything about himself or herself, should not share any details about private life, preferences, tastes, liking or disliking the patient, feeling well today or having a headache today, nothing. So the analyst is like a blank screen onto which the patient will project, and then the analyst will understand that. The understanding is the most important part of Freudian approach. Freud believed what cures people with mental disorders was truth. So no medication, no support, no empathy, no being kind, no opening yourself to other person, no opening yourself to the street, but truth. He had his method. He believed his method would lead him to the truth. He would understand, and then he would deliver the understanding to the patient. So that's the basis of the model. I understand faster than you do because I'm already trained in psychoanalysis and analyzed by Freud. Freud, of course, was never analyzed, but he believed and made other people believe that he was a genius, a messiah, if you will. So he would deliver this knowledge to you, and this knowledge, this understanding will cure you. The insight was considered curable. Neurotics suffer from forgetting, as Anna O did, and then Freud would help them remember and understand, and then the symptoms would disappear. The only reason for psychoanalytic treatment to last long is that interpreting once is not enough, because trauma makes consequences which generalize very quickly. It works like a wildfire, if you will. So you have to extinguish the fire at many places in many instances. To be able to do that, we use various forms of psychotherapeutic interventions. The most important one, in the view of Freud and all later followers of the conflict model, was interpretation. Interpretations are analysts' insights into how the unconscious of the patient works, and then trying to explain to the patient what really happens now. So whenever you notice that the patient is repeating a pattern of behavior that he or she should use in childhood, then you try to say that. You are now feeling the same what you felt 20 years ago or something like that. You are now in a relationship that is very similar to your relationship with this and that or that person at that point in your life. This was considered to be the most important tool. Then learning how to use it was considered the most important thing in the education of a psychoanalyst. And you would spend a lot of time in your supervisions practicing a very precise and timely transference interpretations. So these are some of the rules as to how we try to make our interpretations as good as possible. So they should be timely. Sometimes you have to wait for a long time before you can interpret what you have understood previously. You should try to be succinct and exact. Interpretations, if they are too long, will lose their power. And finally, you should try to use the everyday language, not too much of... I had a discussion with students yesterday morning about whether you can say to a patient, "I feel empathy," whether patients understand what this sentence could mean. So we interpret in the clinical setting different things, but mostly resistance and transference. Resistance is about the forces inside which don't want you to improve. You come to the treatment. You may come 4 times per week. In Freudian times, you may come 10 times per week. You give it a lot of time. You give it a lot of money. You give it some effort, intellectual and emotional. And yet, at least one part of yourself does not want to change, does not want to improve. We call it resistance, and interpreting resistances is something that is extremely important. First, you finish with resistances, then you can start working with other things. If you skip this part, and try working on other things before finishing with resistances, you are in danger that the patient will not improve at all, that the patient will improve just superficially. The other basic point, which psychoanalysts sometimes are obsessed with, is called transference. Transference is defined in various ways. Freud, in The Interpretation of Dreams, in the probably most important seventh chapter of the book, said he believed there was something in the unconscious, an imago, an image of something that happened to you or an important person you were attached to. And then in your preconscious, and these concepts will be clearer 2 weeks from today when we talk about psychoanalysis as personality theory, that these two images get connected. Your experience from the past, which is buried deep in your unconscious, repressed, and your experience from today, which is in your preconscious, they somehow get connected. The energy from the conscious, from the unconscious, connects with the image in the preconscious, and so this image becomes very important. So you may the energy which is connected with the image, with the mental representation, which is deep in your unconscious because it is related to some past experiences, gets connected to an image that was made up today or over the last week, and which is in your preconscious, so not deeply repressed yet. So this image becomes very important because the energy comes to it from the unconscious. That is what Freud believed. So the person you've met a couple of weeks ago all of a sudden is absolutely ideal, absolutely a perfect analyst, the best analyst ever, the first person ever who can understand you properly. Or negligent, uncareful, not really empathetic, not really analytic, and so on and so on. You want your analyst to be in love with you, or you feel in love with your analyst, or you feel so angry at your analyst that you don't know what you would do to him or her. And all these emotions belong to the past and belong to the unconscious and are just briefly related to this person. Hopefully briefly, if the analyst knows what he or she is doing. I like to say to the students, if the patient is talking about you in psychoanalysis, then most probably the patient is talking about someone else. But if the patient is talking about someone else with a lot of emotions, then most probably the patient is talking about you. The transference could be positive and negative, as I said. The patient may feel positive emotions toward you and negative emotions toward you. And we say the transference could be maternal or paternal, when we expect of our analyst to provide something that stereotypically we connect to the maternal or paternal role in development. Also, transferences could be neurotic and psychotic and so on and so on. This is a huge topic in psychoanalysis, and probably there are countless books about transference. So while Freud was still alive, a person appeared in Budapest and then in Berlin and then in London finally. She lived and worked, Melanie Klein, who made this conflict model grow to even further extreme. With Freud, conflict was basic, but conflict was related to Oedipus structure. This is something that in development belongs to the period 3 to 5 or 6 years of age. With Melanie Klein, the conflict was present at the moment when you're born. And we will talk about that 2 weeks from today. I'll try to present to you the model of personality that she tried to develop. Everything is present at the moment when you're born, and all the conflicts are there. So especially when it comes to infants, it is a constant war. It is a constant Armageddon, if you will. They are so-called internal objects which are constantly in war. So in her work with patients, Melanie Klein would use interpreting in here and now only. She would not say, this now is connected to something before. She would always try to say, this what you feel toward this person, or this with children, the way that you're playing is connected to what your parents do today or to what you feel toward me today. So always in here and now. In the Kleinian model, interpreting is very frequent. Sometimes I have a feeling when I read Kleinian case presentations as if I'm watching Wimbledon. It's just serve and volley. Whatever the patient says, you interpret. The patient says another sentence, you interpret. I may be exaggerating, but it's not too far from that, I would say. One clear reason for that, I believe, is Melanie Klein was the first person who tried to work with children. She was one of the first psychoanalysts and the most famous psychoanalyst of the early period who analyzed children and used interpretations. So she would let children play, she would observe their play, and then she would use interpretations as if she was working with adults. So Donald Meltzer, one of her most famous analysants and followers, says the best thing about Kleinian method. Mrs. Klein used the same language to talk with children and to talk with adults, and she used the same language to talk with colleagues and to talk with patients. So reading Klein is sometimes a very challenging job. One point is she grew up in German language tradition and then moved to London and started writing in English. Another point, she uses these very unusual, probably concepts, but maybe not concepts, like good breast and bad breast, and then part objects and whole objects and so on. Sorry?
She went to therapy, she was very thick, and then
yes. She was deeply depressed, and then she read one short paper by Freud, and then she was analyzed by Ferenczi in Budapest, and Ferenczi spotted her talent, although she's never had any sort of university education. He recommended her to become a psychoanalyst, so she came to Berlin to be analyzed by Carl Abraham. Then Abraham died in the middle of her analysis, and then she moved to London. Ernst Jones wanted her to come to London and analyze his children. And then she became the all-powerful figure in the English psychoanalysis for decades to come. So Kleinian model is, in a way, Freudian conflict model brought to the extreme. In another way, Freudian model was present in the work of people whom we call today American ego psychology tradition. So completely different theoretically. Ego psychology wouldn't tell you that the basis of everything was conflict, but they read Freud's technical papers as many people read the Bible. What Freud recommended, they thought we must apply every single detail of it in our everyday work. So this is Kurt Eisler, an emigre from Germany to the United States and the director of Sigmund Freud Archives. I underline this because Sigmund Freud Archives is probably the most conservative psychoanalytic institution ever. There are the papers, and they will not let you read Freud's correspondences or other papers about his life, I think until the year 2042. I like to say to students, first we will learn who shot Kennedy, and then we will learn what Freud wrote to someone, which is probably completely irrelevant for anything. So Eisler thought psychoanalytic sessions should be like experiments that psychologists do in their labs. This was 1940s, 1950s in the United States. Behaviorism was very influential. So Eisler believed psychoanalytic situations should be organized so as that all variables are controlled and just one variable manipulated. So you may remember, whoever studied psychology, this is the basics of the methodology you use for some kinds of empirical research. So what was this variable that you could change that was interpretation? So everything else must be constant. You just introduce your interpretation, and then you see whether anything changes in the patient. If it does, then it's the consequence of your interpretation. So many psychoanalysts around the world, that's probably the most ridiculous example that I know, they would have in their offices several suits. They would be completely the same. So each time you come for a session, your analyst looks completely the same. At least he is dressed completely the same. And of course, the setting is absolutely neutral, impersonal. Nothing changes in it. So whenever you come, I say only good morning. We never shake hands. I'm completely silent. Then you come to the couch. Then you talk. And then I give you the interpretation. Everything else is constant. We never change. For instance, if you cannot come tomorrow at 6 o'clock in the afternoon, I will not offer 2 o'clock, even if I can. Because that would be a change of a variable, so I don't know whether my interpretations work. Okay. I won't give any value judgments. So, that is very briefly one side of it. The other side we call the deficit theory. The idea of the deficit theory, why we call it a deficit theory, is that psychoanalysis should not be focused on conflicts. It should be focused on parts of our clients' personalities that did not develop properly. That our clients have some sides, some aspects, or instances, if you will, in their personalities, which were not developed, and then we should provide for them an opportunity to develop this that their parents or whoever were not able or interested to help them develop. The idea was developed mostly in the second half of the 20th century, and it had many different names. So what I call here basically deficit theory has many different names. It could be called mutuality. Then in the United States, there is a tradition of interpersonal psychoanalysis. Then more recently, relational or intersubjective. And some use the concept of two-person psychology. I give you these various names to underline this is not one solid group. These are many different versions, schools, connected and disconnected. One may be working in Edinburgh, completely isolated. Some may be working in London, but misunderstood by their contemporaries, and so on and so on. So what is it? This is another way to say it. There is one clear line of development from Freud to Melanie Klein, and to the now probably the most famous psychoanalyst in the world, Otto Kernberg, inclusive of ego psychology and Wilfred Bion, whom we are not really sure where to connect. And then on the other side, the second line starts with Sandor Ferenczi, goes to the independent school of British psychoanalysis, and then to these various strands of American thinking. What they basically believe is that the unconscious of the psychoanalyst is not only influenced by patients' projections or whatever the mechanisms are called, we'll talk about that later, but that it influences the process and the patient all the time. So when you want to work with the intimate side of other people's lives, the intimate side of your life will be present all the time. So, when you give the best or the worst of the interpretations, how about the moment when you do it, and the tone of voice that you do it, and all the other aspects of your communication that may be unconscious or may be nonverbal in psychoanalytic psychotherapy? You are always present as a person. You cannot deliver interpretations as a machine. over the last probably 10 years, a computerized version of cognitive behavioral therapy was developed. I cannot imagine this possible for psychoanalysis. So these ideals of Freudian and ego-psychological approach that I mentioned to you earlier are now considered to be impossible. And not only that, they are considered to be harmful. More and more psychoanalysts believe that people come to treatment because they develop mental disorders as a consequence of their parents being neutral, anonymous, and distant. So if you are the same to them during the treatment, that will be perceived as too cold. They will come to you to find cure from the consequences of this, and then you will offer the same, so their despair, if you will just be cemented. So, what is curative is now considered not to be the interpretation, but the relationship. Be in a relationship with this person, be in a personal relationship with him or her, try to empathize, try to be open, to discover some things together, try to learn from the patient, try to be treated by the patient, and so on. So the focus, I told you, in the conflict model was resistance and transference. The focus on what is called countertransference comes after the World War II, when the second model is starting to be developed. Countertransference in the beginning was considered to be the emotions that are being born in us under the influence of the patient. So patients do something to us, so we feel something. Otherwise, we are beings who do not feel, unless patients do something to us. So Freud wrote about the need to be purified from the countertransference, as if it was a disease, an infection, or something like that. Has to do a lot with stories which we, in a way, I still believe, should be embarrassed about. Jung Spielrein affair and Ernst Jones and his female patients in Canada and so on. And probably some parts of Freud's own personality. But for the next 40 years, countertransference was never seen as something that inevitably has to be there. That in every form of human communication, you have some likings and dislikings, some anxieties and some happiness and whatever it might be. That emotions are a natural process in human beings. So it's only over the last decades that we are focused on this issue. So again, I'll give you the historical beginning. It is with a person who was neglected in the history of psychoanalysis for decades. Ferenczi died in 1933, and his probably most important book or document was published in English in 1988, in French a couple of years earlier. And in the period between 1930s and 1980s, if you look at the PEP web, for instance, you will find that no one is quoting him. He does not exist. Ferenczi was born in a small northwestern Hungarian town of Miskolc. He had his studies in Vienna, and later on he worked in Budapest. Before he met Freud, he was interested in something that used to be called spiritism. And he would do what many poets would do a couple of decades after him, automatic writing. He would try to make the pen write so freely without his influence that the sentences would be the product of his unconscious. So his unconscious told him through his pen, if I may phrase it like that, that he must write a paper on spiritism and publish it in a journal. Spiritism and telepathy were things that he was very much interested in. How do we transfer, if you will, thoughts and emotions to other people? How do we influence them psychologically? How does that happen? He believed that that was happening for the beginning. So he read The Interpretation of Dreams. He wrote to Freud. He went to Vienna. 1908, the correspondence starts. These are three thick volumes. I think all in all about 2,000 letters, one of the most important documents in the history of early psychoanalysis. Freud analyzed Ferenczi on three brief occasions for a couple of weeks, all in all 130 sessions. Today we would consider that very brief analysis. And Freud wrote some wonderful things about Ferenczi. Freud was not praising his followers very frequently. In the obituary, he said Ferenczi was the best clinician of us all. And before that, he said Ferenczi was a one-person institute in Budapest. And Freud almost wanted Ferenczi to marry his daughter Mathilde. In the second half of the 1920s, Ferenczi had several very important patients. So now there is a belief that one of them was to him what Anna O was to Breuer and Freud. The document that I told you was probably the most important piece that he wrote is called Clinical Diary. This is a set of notebooks into which Ferenczi wrote his remarks after sessions or what he dreamt or whatever would come to his mind. So these were given after his death, these were given to Michael Balint. Balint brought these notebooks to London when he immigrated and translated them into English. During the 1960s, no one would publish them. That is the censorship in the world of psychoanalysis. The diary was first published in French, then in English, and then in many other languages. And in this book, he frequently writes about the patient whose coded name he used, the coded name RN. Sometimes he says, my queen or countess, his most important patient. Freud would say for that same person that she was Ferenczi's devil. That's how strong feelings were connected to the person whose name was Elizabeth Severn, who was an American believing that her profession was to be a metaphysician. She was trying to help people through working as a metaphysician. What we know about her treatment is that she would come to Budapest several times during the 1920s. And gradually, Severn and Ferenczi would discover that she was very severely traumatized in three different points in time during her childhood. The first one probably when she was a year and a half old, then about 5 years, and then about 11 years. Her father was sexually abusing her, inducing drugs and alcohol, and all sorts of other horrible traumata. She felt suicidal as a child. She was dissociated, Ferenczi claimed, into three different personalities, and so on and so on. She contemplated suicide also in Budapest. She thought about jumping into the Danube. So Ferenczi would give her double sessions, or sessions would last for hours, sometimes for 3 or 4 or 5 hours, sometimes during the night. Sometimes she would not be able to walk or go out of her room, so he would go to her hotel and give her a session there. And despite all these efforts that probably no supervisor of today would recommend to you that you should use them, there was no improvement. He was not able to help her. So what happened was that Severn told Ferenczi at one point, you cannot help me because you hate me. You cannot help me because you have resistances. There were superficial symptoms like headache, but she believed that deep inside him, Ferenczi was not able to help her because of that, because he was in resistance. So what happened at that moment is the beginning of what we today call, with historical distance, mutual analysis. Severn would analyze Ferenczi. During this period, he would discover that indeed, despite his outwardly friendly attitude, in fact, deep inside him, he did hate her. The moment he managed to overcome this, he was able to help her and her treatment improved. There were various stories about how and why Ferenczi conducted his analysis. He himself was aware that he was a victim of what he believed he had recognized in many people, what he called compulsory caregiving. That there are people who cannot but do whatever they can or give whatever they have to other people. He probably was never loved by his mother as he wanted to be, so he tried to be the best possible mother to his patients, and so on and so on. What is now particularly interesting and what goes beyond the story of Anna O is that Severn published a book, The Discovery of the Self. And it was only, I think, not more than 3 years ago, that Professor Peter Rudnitsky discovered that in this book, Severn coded her analysis of Ferenczi. So we can read in a book how she analyzed Ferenczi and what she learned about him. And then if we look together at the clinical diary and the discovery of the self, we can finally see what and how happened there. Professor Rudnitsky is now editing the new edition of this book. It should be available by Routledge next year, if you're interested in it. To my mind, the most important representative of this tradition in psychoanalysis is Donald Winnicott. And I think this is the photograph, I hope you can see it clearly. I think this is the photograph that tells you who the person was the best. Winnicott died 70-something, 75, and for about 25 years, he had cardiac problems and a series of heart attacks. Yet it might happen to patients that they come for a session and Winnicott is in the other part of his house playing the piano. He would run in between the sessions to play Beethoven a little bit. Deep into his 70s, he enjoyed climbing the trees. He was a pediatrician whom people believe saw about 60,000 mothers and infants. He had an experience that no psychoanalyst will ever be able to compare with. He was the master of playfulness with infants. He would invent ways to play with infants so that you can realize what is going on with them. He was probably a particularly talented person to understand the nonverbal, what was not expressed in words. James Anderson published a paper 2 years ago after a series of interviews with people who were analyzed by Winnicott. So what I would like to emphasize to you, and then unfortunately again briefly, is not his theoretical contributions, which are enormous. I truly believe the moment will come when psychoanalysts will admit that Winnicott was the most creative psychoanalyst of the 20th century and not Freud. In his clinical work, Winnicott was everything that Freud or Klein or Eisler would never allow you to do. One of the persons Anderson interviewed said, "In my professional capacity, I have met about 10,000 mothers, and none of them was a better mother than Winnicott." Sounds strange for a male person to be the best mother, but that, in fact, is one of the most important points of his theory and one of the most important points of his clinical work. So Winnicott used to say, "I use interpretations just to show to the patient where is the limit of my understanding. When I come to the limit of my understanding, I share this to the patient so that he or she would know, beyond this, now I need to learn, now I need to discover. At this moment, I don't understand it." He used to say about one of his clinical cases This was a very good interpretation. The only problem was I used it 6 years prematurely. So imagine his ideal psychoanalysis then probably would last 15 or 20 years. Winnicott was the first person to say openly, change your technique, don't change the patient. Even today, most prominent Kleinian analysts will tell you, my technique is correct. The patient needs to adapt to it. The patient needs to learn how to use it and how to improve thanks to it. Winnicott believed the opposite. We need to adapt. So he would try to see what was the point when the patient's development was, as they would like to say it in the United States, arrested. So with one of the patients, he realized that her experience, her impression was, she was not greeted, as Ferenczi would say, she was not welcomed by her parents. They were not happy, they were not jubilant that she was born, that she was around. So what would he do? One option for a psychoanalyst would be to transform this into an interpretation that he would say to the patient in one of the sentences, 6 years before or later. But Winnicott would look very carefully through the curtains to see when the patient is coming near to his house. So he would go to the door, to the entrance door, and open the door, I mean softly, open the door a moment, a second, before the patient would ring the bell. So he would give her a small message, I'm waiting for you. I'm here, attentive, and I will open the door before you ring. You don't need to show me that you're here, I already care about that. So that's a small message that cannot change for the message that her parents gave her that they didn't care about her. But day after day, day after day, and it should introduce or inspire some improvement. Some of the patients talked about his enormous talent for helping people simply be who they are, be how they feel. The second wife of the aforementioned Michael Balint would go to Winnicott after Balint died. And this president of the British Psychoanalytic would let her sit on the floor, hold his hand and cry, and wouldn't say anything. Wouldn't give interpretations, wouldn't tell her, okay, this week it will go like that, but next week we go psychoanalysis proper. As long as she needed simply to cry, he would let her cry. One of the most touching examples is that he said to one of the patients, you can cry on my hands. So providing a framework, providing a holding, as he would say, for her emotions of loss and sadness. I hope that you will enjoy reading Winnicott as much as I do. He, to my mind, is the most inspiring psychoanalytic author, both in his poetical style and the depth of his thinking and in his unique clinical approach. When I read the paper by Anderson, I remember very clearly it was on the Tegel airport waiting for a plane. I felt, finally, psychoanalysis, as I always imagined it in its best version, does exist.
It's a very humane approach. What, if I sum it up?
Yes, that's one of its sides. It's very humane. Then you have to be with the person for long. Then you have to let this other person develop without interfering. Then you have to play a lot. You have to be very creative. Winnicott used to say, the first thing you should pay attention to in a patient is whether he or she can play or not. If the patient cannot play, and in this sense, play would be use metaphors, free associate, be funny, be creative, and so on, then first the patient needs to learn how to play, and then psychotherapy can start. So there are different capacities needed for that. deeply, being deeply humane is definitely one of them. So some historians of psychoanalysis say then America got its own Winnicott. His name was Heinz Kohut. Kohut today is believed to be a theorist who was probably the best reader of them all. He read everything and he took bits and pieces from different theories and he came up with his own theory. In his day, he was quite revolutionary. He immigrated from Vienna to Chicago, and there he graduated from the famous Chicago Institute of Psychoanalysis, and they called him Mr. Psychoanalysis. He was teaching Freud in Chicago for decades. He was the president of the American and the vice president of the International Psychoanalytic Associations, one of the most prominent persons in the psychoanalytic world. 1959, he published a paper about empathy, and everything was over. Until 1959, it may be curious for you to hear that, until 1959, no one published a paper about empathy in the world of psychoanalysis. Ferenczi would mention it, Otto Rank would mention it, but no one wrote really clear papers about it. Kohut claimed empathy is as important for our psychological development as oxygen is for our physiological development. No oxygen, you die physiologically. No empathy, you die psychologically. So he believed the idea of neutrality, anonymity, and distance was ridiculous because we were not observing distant stars or planets. We were observing people with whom we communicate, and it was impossible to believe on the level of the philosophy of science to be completely separate from the object of your observation. In order to observe another person, you must somehow be involved, included in that person's emotional life. So when Kohut presented this paper in 1957 at the American Psychoanalytic Association Congress, he was killed, to put it simply. They criticized him so badly, and he, for some time, was not allowed to publish the paper. Another instance of psychoanalytic censorship. Only after the intervention of one very important American psychoanalyst of that time, they would allow the paper to be published. He published three more papers on empathy until the end of his life, and that was one of the most important topics in his work. Out of that came his very important theory on narcissistic personality disorders, which are now one of the prominent points in contemporary classifications of mental disorders and contemporary psychopathology. Kohut believed that every one of us, as children, would have a need to merge with another person, most probably with parents, to feel being in a unity with another person, whom we could idealize and who would idealize us. So he believed one of the basic needs that we have is to have parents with whom we would be together and feel that they are powerful and smart and skillful and so on and so on. And also to be together with our parents and that they feel very happy that we are funny or good in sports or good in school and so on and so on. If this does not happen, this person will suffer for the rest of his or her life from the need to always look for a person or persons they would be able to merge with. So that was, in Kohut's opinion, the basis of the narcissistic personality disorder. That was why some people have a very strong need to follow powerful political leaders, to use drugs, to always be, so to say, acutely in love, acutely, yes. to always have followers or follow someone. And if a person like that, suffering from these problems, would come to psychoanalytic treatment, and you try to interpret all the time, and you say to this person, you are now idealizing me because, then Koch would believe that would be harmful. What a psychoanalyst must do is endure this period when the patient would try to be close, to be unseparated, to be merged, because that is exactly the early developmental need that must be overcome. So you have to endure this period and hope that the patient will outgrow and not that it will be overcome through interpretation. Yes?
So, but isn't that what the patients are doing in this sort of life generally?
Yes. Yes.
So what would you then do in order to overcome this in the brain? If he's not interpreting it?
The analyst will never become the leader or the follower. The analyst will never offer to be idealized or start idealizing. The analyst just should, in Koch's opinion, endure this period without too much interpretation. May use other forms of therapeutic interventions that I had on the slide previously. So sometimes you may reflect. Sometimes you may say how you understand the situation, but you will not use those ways of connecting this to the past, of connecting this to the transference. It's too early. It's like talking to a toddler and trying to explain something that is cognitively and emotionally beyond his or her reach. You need to wait. The patient must outgrow of this through your careful handling of the situation and some very finely tuned interventions, which are not heavy artillery of Kleinian interpretation. So Koch died in 1981 of cancer. At the same time, other dissidents in the American psychoanalysis were present. One is Harris Tech Sullivan, who founded the interpersonal tradition in American psychoanalysis, who was never a member of the American, and people who follow the interpersonal even today are trained at the William Ellison White Institute, which only this year the American psychoanalytic started an initiative to include into the American. The basic reason is what we will return to very soon, not enough candidates. So now it is not that interpersonal approach has become acceptable, it is we should survive, so give us what you have. There was also a tradition of American psychoanalysts who work with psychotic patients psychoanalytically, most prominently in the Chestnut Lodge Hospital. Two most important names there were Frieda von Reichmann and Harold Searles, two persons who would work with the most difficult patients, with psychotic patients who acutely were hallucinant or delusional and so on. And when treatments would last for years and in a setting that was completely different than the classical Freudian psychoanalytic one. If the patient would have to be restrained to the bed, then Frieda von Reichmann would take the chair and sit by the bed and do the session there. If they would need to walk around the park because the patient is restless and cannot sit, they would walk around the park. And so on and so on. The work of Frieda von Reichmann has become popular through the novel and film entitled I Never Promised You a Rose Garden. So it's much easier to read the novel than her theoretical papers. The novel is written by the person who was analyzed by Frieda von Reichmann, Joanie Greenberg, who was considered incurable by many psychiatrists, and then after a long psychoanalysis with von Reichmann was cured, and then she left the hospital and she wrote, I think, 12 books by now, and she got married and has children and by now grandchildren, and he's living life outside of the world of mental health care for decades. Yes. Frieda von Reichmann lived, I think, in Wiesbaden, and she analyzed Erich Fromm. She was several years older than he was, and she was his analyst, and then they stopped the analysis and got married. But they then immigrated to the United States, and there separated and divorced. The marriage was not long-lived, and he became far more famous than she was. From, I think, The Art of Loving was sold in 25 million copies world around. That's how famous he was at one moment, and Frieda von Reichmann was never very widely known outside of the professional circles. So probably the most important current American tradition, which to a large extent now absorbs other traditions into itself, is relational psychoanalysis. It started mid-1980s with the work of Stephen Mitchell, who sadly passed away in the year 2000 when he was only 54 years old. And Mitchell, revolutionary, changed the framework with more audacity than probably anyone before him. There were psychoanalysts who were disappointed and then founded other forms of treatment. Cognitive behavioral or gestalt or client-centered psychotherapy were all founded by disappointed psychoanalysts. Mitchell said, "What I do is still psychoanalysis. I just want to tell you one thing. Whatever Freud wrote in his metapsychological papers about drives and sexuality and death drive and so on, that was wrong. We need to keep psychoanalysis, but we need to go further than Freud." Professor Rudnitsky, whom I've mentioned already, wrote a book a couple of years ago, which is entitled Rescuing Psychoanalysis from Freud. So that is one of the current trends in the United States. Not improve Freud, not complement Freud, but get rid of Freud and go on. He had some historical contribution and then forget about it and work with patients your own way. Yes?
So what's left of psychoanalysis if you take out Freud?
Well, many different things. Just what we should be concerned with is, on the one hand, Freudian approach. I know everything. I don't need scientific study. I don't need outside collaboration. I don't need personal analysis. I already know everything. And on the second point, it's what is called Freudian metapsychology. So Freud's idea that drives are the most important, that has never been corroborated by any biologist, anthropologist, evolutionary biologist, or anyone. The idea of death drive, the idea of the conflict between the sexual and death drives, and so on. We will talk about that in 2 weeks. What should be left is the primacy of the idea of the importance of the relationship. It is present in Freud, but he writes about transference, for instance, and so on. And that is the basic idea for Mitchell. Relationships are primary, drives are secondary. So relationships, if relationships would be like streets and pathways, then those relationships which include strong drives and wishes are like highways. Not that they don't exist. They don't exist. Not that they don't influence our lives. Just relationships come first, and those relationships which involve strong emotions and strong wishes are particularly exciting or pleasurable or important. But they are just a specific form of relationships. So based on this, the way psychoanalysts in the United States, mostly on the coasts, New York and California, The way they work with patients is based on Mitchell's idea of relational matrix. So whatever happens between people or among people and in a session happens in a relational matrix. One person contributes, the other person contributes, and then it gets entangled in strange and mysterious ways. And our job is to understand this, how patients contribute, how we contribute, and then how it will develop. So out of that came the idea that disclosure is something absolutely natural. That for the analyst to say something about his or her personality is absolutely natural. Disclosure means to open up to the patient. To say, when the patient tells you, I'm very sad because my brother is ill, that you may say, when my brother was ill, I was also sad. So in the world of Freudian and Kleinian psychoanalysis, that would be inconceivable. I have read case presentations where psychoanalysts cry during the session or say to the patient how sorry they are for what happened to the patient. I have been present at a supervision session where the supervisor and the person who presented the material have never met before. And the supervisor read the material for the first time, and several minutes into the session, I realized the supervisor was crying. It was... It's very difficult with Americans to say their age, but probably a man of around 60, a prominent training analyst with long beard, very masculine, and he was crying unashamedly, and he did not try to hide it. So disclosing your feelings, your attitudes, and so on and so on, is not something that's forbidden today.
Why was he crying?
He was so touched by what happened to the patient that he was reading and hearing about. The childhood history of the patient was so traumatic that he was touched by that, and then he started crying. So one very important new strand, to which we will return next week, is called psychoanalytic constructivism. In psychoanalysis for decades, we believed the analyst knows and then he gives you the knowledge. Now some psychoanalysts move to a completely different position. The knowledge is constructed by two persons who are in the interaction, and this specific form of interaction we call psychoanalytic session, but they together find the meaning of what is going on. To my mind, it sounds strange that we needed so many decades to accept this while the rest of the world was aware of it for a long time. There is a very prominent relational theory called intersubjective theory, and it develops now into various directions toward feminism and gender studies, toward political studies, conflict resolution, and so on. One of the basic ideas is that we, for decades, thought of a psychoanalytic situation as involving one subject and one object. One of us, most usually, strangely though it may sound, the patient would be the subject who was doing something, feeling something, trying to influence, acting out, or this or that. And the analyst would be the passive receiver of it and then the deliverer of interpretations. At one point, one person does something, the other person is passive. At the next point, the other person does something and the first one who was active is now passive. The intersubjectivity theory claims that there is always a struggle about intersubjectivity. It is impossible for you to feel, to recognize yourself as a subject unless other persons would recognize you as a subject. You always need other people, and through communication only you can feel, you can become, you can develop as a subject. At the same time, allowing the other person to be a subject means allowing them their own free will and the decision to leave you, to humiliate you, to say, okay, I like you to a certain extent, but not very much, and so on. So without the other person as a subject, you cannot be a subject yourself. But with the other person as a subject, you risk very much. So this constant ambivalence is something that is considered by several very prominent relational authors to be the basis of our clinical work. So this has lasted very long, but I hope you'll bear with me for a couple of more moments as I try to wrap this up with several remarks about where psychoanalysis is today. So, as you've seen, there are many approaches and sometimes conflicting. Kleinians would not talk to relationalists or Winnicottians, although Winnicottians is not a good term. Relational psychoanalysts would not like to hear about Klein. There is a very strong Lacanian school that goes its own way. The deficit model did not make the conflict model disappear. They now exist simultaneously, and so on. Psychoanalysis suffers for decades now from having fewer and fewer candidates. The most prominent institutes in the United States would graduate several persons per week. Per year. It would be wonderful to be per week. So like Chicago Institute would have 6 graduates per year. Columbia University Institute would graduate 8 persons per year. So psychoanalysis, in a way, is suffering from becoming very old and having very insecure future. Most psychoanalysts work in psychoanalytic psychotherapy, so with people coming once or twice per week and not using the couch. The classical psychoanalytic treatment, as described in Freud's papers and that I described to you at the beginning of this presentation, is now mostly limited to training analysis. When you start your training to become a psychoanalyst, you go for your personal analysis for years, then you go 4 or 5 times per week and you use the couch, and that's more or less that. Very few people today are motivated to go somewhere 4 times per week just for the fun of it or for the curiosity of it. Psychoanalysis is a big hit in Latin America. So in Buenos Aires, there are 3,000 psychoanalysts just in one city. Psychoanalysis is a big topic in Brazil, in Chile, in Mexico. It's a big topic everywhere in Eastern Europe. It has reached Irkutsk and deep Siberian cities. It's becoming a huge topic in Asia, in China, in Korea, and in India. I have been at the American Psychoanalytic this January and the International last year in Boston, and it is not at all what it used to be. Middle class, Western male, 55 to 70 years of age. Now there are more and more women, there are more and more people of different origin, and so on and so on. There are 13,000 members of the International Psychoanalytic Association worldwide. So probably China will produce another 13,000 within the next 5 years, and we'll see how that will influence our lives. Psychoanalysis is more and more open to new ways of communicating. So the president, the current president of the International, Italian psychoanalyst Stefano Bolognini, he sent the letter to all the 13,000 members recently. Skype analysis will not be recognized as a training analysis. There are groups in the United States and Europe which provide training using the Skype. As I told you, people like Horst Kechele are doing research to see how effective it is, and so on and so on. It is becoming more open. In places like Mexico City, it is impossible because of the size of the city and the disorganization, probably I should say, of the public transportation. it's impossible for people to come to a session three times per week. Even people who live in the same city use Skype. So that is changing. Finally, psychoanalysis gets more and more open to process and outcome research, to trying to use scientific approaches to understand what happens inside the session. How about silences? Why patients cry at a certain moment? What happens after that? If you say, four times per minute, how will the patient feel? And so on. And then the outcome studies, which show us, does this really help? Who helps better? Male therapists or female therapists? Or this or that? So psychoanalysis was closed for this for decades, but now becomes more and more open. That being said, I would like to tell you next week, unfortunately you don't see the last line of my slide, I don't know why. No. So next week I will try to tell you about the history of psychoanalysis as a scientific discipline, and process and outcome studies will be a part of that. I repeat my emails if you want to send me any questions or comments. And here on my presentation it says Stillpoint Spaces, Berlin, May 26th, 2016. Yes?
Short question.
Yeah.
Just repeating what you said, I didn't understand right. You said psychoanalysis is in decline in the Western world.
Yes.
And rising in the Western, Latin America,
yes,
developing world.
In the Western world, in the Western Europe and the United States, we have a rise of pharmacological industry and cognitive behavioral therapy, and decline of psychoanalysis. And the opposite outside of that geographical area. Latin America, Asia, Eastern Europe.
You have explanation for that.
Sorry?
You have explanation for something that you can add on that, but you just wanted that.
One thing that is definitely a fact about Eastern Europe and Asia, it is new there, it is fresh there. So I can tell you many details about Eastern Europe. My professors were, in a way, prohibited when they wanted to teach psychoanalysis. The first counseling service, psychoanalytic counseling service in Belgrade, which was founded in 1959, was closed because of the political ideas. Psychoanalysis was believed to be a bourgeois philosophy, completely relevant for the socialist society. So the late 1980s and the 1990s, everyone was into psychoanalysis. I cannot tell you about Asia. I cannot understand in what way psychoanalysis is relevant for the way they raise their kids and their educational styles and emotional expression and so on. I have never been there, so I cannot understand it. But the fact is the same. Psychology is a new, a young science there, and psychoanalysis is a young discipline there. So people travel from various places, psychoanalysts travel from various places in Western Europe to China to train huge numbers of people in their hospitals how to work with patients psychoanalytically. And it's a hit there. Then Latin America is a different case because it has been a long and strong tradition there, and very original, different than European or North American psychoanalysis. But why, I don't know, I cannot tell you. Okay, I close with this usual expression of my gratitude for you to bearing with me for this very, very long presentation, and I'm still open for your questions or comments if you have any.